सर एंड आई गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू एंड आई ब्रिंग ग्रीटिंग्स फ्रॉम आवर हॉस्पिटल भगवान महावीर कैंसर हॉस्पिटल जयपुर. सो वेन एवर द वी टॉक अबाउट द रिसेंट एडवांसेस इन द एडजुवेंट हर टू पॉजिटिव ब्रेस्ट कैंसर, वी नीड टू टॉक इन टर्म्स ऑफ वेदर देर इज अ न्यू ड्रग और वेदर देर इज अ न्यू रेजिमेन और वेदर देर इज अ चेंज इन ड्यूरेशन ऑफ द ट्रीटमेंट और इफ देर इज अ न्यू सरोगेट मार्कर फॉर प्राइमरी एंड पॉइंट. बिकॉज वन ड्रग मे नॉट बी यू नो फुलफिलिंग ऑल द क्राइटेरिया बट स्टिल मे बी a very good having results in certain subsets of the patients because this is an era of precision medicine. So we need to select that in which subset of the patient this particular drug is working.
Four zero
so when you have the multiple options in this field, then you are really confused, you know, so how to proceed. So I try to sort out the conundrum. I try to sort out the conundrum. And we will discuss that which drug works in which subset of the patient. So there are some certain anatomical factors like axillary lymph node status and tumor size, and certain biological factors like histologic subtype, grade, proliferation indices, ERPR status, and HER2 overexpression. So when we talk about the risk factor, the HER2 new portent a very high risk to the patient, irrespective of the tumor size, lymph node status. And the hormone receptor status, whether it is a negative and positive, HER2 positivity itself is a risk factor. And in today's talk, beside trastuzumab, which we all know, we are aware about this drug, we will talk briefly about the neratinib, pertuzumab, and the T-DM1. So whenever we talk about the adjuvant HER2 therapy, we will take into consideration the following parameters: whether patient received or not received the new adjuvant therapy. And second parameter is the whether there is a residual disease or there is a pathological complete response post neoadjuvant therapy. So regarding the choice of chemotherapy, we are very well informed because it's been clearly given in the NCCN guideline. You can choose and pick up any of the drug and try to choose a regimen which has category 1 recommendation. In the present version of the NCCN 2020, there are two category 1 recommendation. One is when there is a no residual disease, we can use the pertuzumab. And if there is a residual disease, then there is a very good and promising data for the T-DM1. So I'll try to discuss all these data briefly. And regarding this P, which they have highlighted in the treatment recommendation, it considered the extended adjuvant neratinib following adjuvant trastuzumab containing therapy for patient with hormone receptor positive and HER2 positive disease with a perceived risk of high recurrence. And the benefit of toxicity is associated with extended neratinib in patient who have received pertuzumab or adult trastuzumab is still not known, but it is category 1 beside the pertuzumab in the patient who did not have any residual disease. So certain trials, first trial is the APT trial, which is a really very good trial, though phase 2. And now we have 8-year follow-up data of APT trial. And surprisingly, this is very underutilized regimen by most of us. But I have experience of using this in nearly 20 patients and very good result, especially if the patient is frail and not ready to accept the aggressive chemotherapy. And it works very well, irrespective of the hormone receptor status. Whether the patient is hormone receptor positive or hormone receptor negative, especially if the tumor size is less than 3 cm. Though only 10% of the patient had tumor less than 10 cm and 90% had tumor less than 2 cm. So this is a 7-year follow-up data was presented at ESCO in 2019. And you can yourself very well appreciate the kind of, Kaplan-Meier curve using the APT trial. So it is a very good regimen in patient who cannot tolerate the aggressive regimen and who have a small HER2 positive early breast cancer. So next in the line is the affinity trial using the adjuvant pertuzumab and trastuzumab in early HER2 positive breast cancer. So this for this drug also we have 6-year follow-up data, and there is a new primary endpoint used in this trial was the invasive disease-free survival. And after the 6 year, there is a difference of nearly 3% in the invasive disease-free survival in the patient having the high risk of recurrence and where we have used the pertuzumab. So this is a note positive and non-negative. As I told you earlier, that note positive this drug especially works in the patient who are node positive and may not work equally well in the patient who are node negative. And invasive disease-free survival by the hormone receptor status, I think again it works very well in hormone receptor positive patients more than the hormone receptor negative patients, with the difference, absolute difference in the invasive disease-free survival of nearly 3%. So next in the turn is the neratinib. And this was the extended trial. And we have, for this trial also, we have 5-year follow-up data. And here also the primary endpoint was invasive disease-free survival analysis. And we can see that the invasive disease-free survival at 5 year had an absolute difference of 3%, which is quite an important difference as far as the large group of the patients are concerned who are going to receive the neratinib in the adjuvant setting. And in this trial also, if we need to dissect who is benefiting the most, so obviously this Kaplan-Meier curve is clearly showing that the invasive disease-free survival was showing a promising result in the patient who had hormone receptor positive. And 5-year invasive disease-free survival by the patient subgroup, if the patient is having a hormone receptor positive and is the less than 1 year from the last dose of trastuzumab, there is an absolute difference of 5.1% in comparison to the patient who are hormone receptor positive and less than 1 year from the last dose of trastuzumab without PCR after neoadjuvant treatment. There is absolute difference in the invasive disease-free survival and of 7.4%. And this itself speaks of this molecule. So this trial again was published in NEJM about the use of trastuzumab, emtansine or T-DM1 for residual invasive HER2-positive breast cancer. And this was the Catherine trial. In this trial also, again, the invasive disease-free survival was taken as the primary endpoint. And you can see that in patient who did not achieve the complete pathological response and was used, the T-DM1 was used, there is a significant difference in the survival curve by using the T-DM1. And in the forest plot also, you can see that it has benefited most of the patients. So this was a very important trial. Considering the biology for the patients who did not achieve the pathological response, and we now know that the biologically these two groups who achieve the pathological response and it do not achieve are entirely two different subgroup of the patients. And this is one group where we do not achieve the pathological complete response. The T-DM1 is showing the very promising data. And it's the, if you consider the secondary endpoint also, so it was it showed a promising result in the prevention of the distant recurrence, though overall survival data is not that impressive. So it was the T-DM1 was used with pertuzumab also, but the results are quite dismal, and the Catalin was not considered as a positive trial in comparison to the Catherine trial. Now, after discussing about the various these trials which have put these new drugs in the adjuvant setting, now we will discuss about the treatment duration. What change has come in the treatment duration? So this is the last publication and very, very robust data from the Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai, about the evaluation of 1 year versus shorter duration of adjuvant trastuzumab among patients with early breast cancer. And this was an individual participation data, and it was a trial level meta-analysis published by the Sudeep Gupta et al. In the JAMA network. And it clearly shows that the both curves are overlapping each other in the less than 1 year and 1 year. So the author concluded that for the patient receiving 1 year of trastuzumab, the disease-free survival was 87% in comparison to the patient who received 6 months, where it was 85.42. And for the patient who received 1 year trastuzumab, the OS was 93.4% in comparison to the 92.39% for the patient who received the 6 months. So this meta-analysis clearly tell us the answer and remove the conundrum of whether it is the 6 months or the 1 year. The answer is very clear from this publication. And in the forest plot also, it was clearly shown that the all the points are falling in the unity line, and the 1 year is not being considered in a certain subgroup of the patient or certain low, biologically low risk patients who are HER2 positive, that the 6 month trastuzumab is sufficient enough. So the result of this meta-analysis tells us that there are 6 eligible trial with the median DFS non-inferiority margin of 1.3 and 5 of which had acceptable individual patient data for 11,000 patients. And 5-year disease-free survival was 85.42 versus 87.12. And 5-year overall survival was 92.3 for 1 year and 93.46 for 6 months. And using the trial level published estimate of these 6 randomized controlled trial, including more than 11,000 patients, 1,760 disease-free survival events and 930 deaths, the hazard ratio for disease-free survival was 1.1, and for overall survival, the hazard ratio was 1.17. And there was significantly less risk beside the benefit in the survival. Significantly less risk in all this group of the patient of the congestive cardiac failure with a shorter duration of the trastuzumab. So this was all about the new information about the duration of the trastuzumab. And the conclusion of this meta-analysis was that the result of this meta-analysis suggests that shorter duration trastuzumab is non-inferior to 1 year administration with respect to disease-free survival and fewer cardiac toxic effects. And the absolute survival difference between the two groups are so small, and shorter duration could be therapeutically appropriate in situation of toxic effects and the resource constraints, especially among patients with clinically low-risk disease. So with the information of all these regimen, all these trials, and the clarity about the duration, so what do we do now in the clinical practice? So it's really, friends, it's very easy. You just need to try to connect the dots. So little bit of side effects, you all are very well aware about that. Mainly the side effects of this anti-HER2 therapy are cardiac toxicity, diarrhea, and thrombocytopenia with each of the these molecules which just now I have discussed. So how do we manage the cardiac dysfunction? This is irreversible. This is the reversible cardiac damage, and we all know the guidelines which we are following in day-to-day practice. And I do not have to go into the details of how do we manage the cardiac dysfunction in the patients who are receiving the HER2 therapy. So the proposed strategy for managing patient with the stage 1, 2, 3 HER2 positive early breast cancer in year 2020 is that if the patient is having a clinically T1, AB, they will all go for surgery and will receive the trastuzumab-based therapy, TH, that is the paclitaxel and the trastuzumab, followed by the trastuzumab for 1 year. That is the APG trial. And they have strongly put this trial in the recommendation. For the patient who have T1C, CN0, we need to assess the risk and the patient preference. And some of these patients might go for the APG trial also. If the tumor is T2, or if the patient is not positive, then these patients will obviously go for neoadjuvant TCHP or the AC followed by THP. So as I enumerated already, that then we need to decide on the basis of whether the patient had residual disease at the end of the neoadjuvant therapy or the patient had the pathological complete response at the end of the neoadjuvant therapy. For the residual disease, we have Catherine data, and the patient will receive the 14 doses of T-DM1. And that's all. And patient, the data for continuation with the neratinib is not available. And we have to stop at 14 cycles of T-DM1. For the patient who achieved the complete pathological response, we need to continue the trastuzumab plus minus pertuzumab for 1 year in both whether the patient is hormone receptor positive or hormone receptor negative. For the patient who are hormone receptor positive, we have discussed the excellent data, and neratinib could be used in these patients. So these are the proposed strategy, and we need to adopt them. So so the question after discussing all this information, so still the question remains that if is there still an elephant in the room? I think with the so much of new information, at least my answer is that no, there is no elephant in the room, and we can very well embrace this newer HER2 therapy in our day-to-day clinical practice. I thank you very much for your patient hearing.